In this video, we focus on vitamins, cofactors, and coenzymes. By the end of this video, we will understand how vitamins relate to the function of enzymes and why vitamins are important. In order to understand why vitamins are essential to the function of proteins, we first need to lay out some of the key groundwork and terminology. We need to define two key words, cofactor and coenzyme. Both of these are types of structures that will bind to proteins to enable the protein to become active. The difference between the two is that a cofactor refers to an ion, that is something with a negative or positive charge that is inorganic, or some other non-protein molecule that binds to a protein to make it active. These have to be inorganic substances. On the other hand, coenzymes represent organic molecules. So common cofactors would be things like iron, zinc, etc. Coenzyme would be substances such as any organic molecule, such as ATP, for example, adenosine triphosphate. Another couple of common coenzymes are NADH, which we will go ahead and show the image of here. As you can see, this is quite a large, bulky molecule. This is a common coenzyme of an oxidoreductase. When molecules are oxidized or reduced, something else has to undergo the opposite procedure. So in other words, when one molecule is oxidized, something else has to be reduced, or if one molecule is reduced, something else has to be oxidized. And NADH is generally the partner in this reaction. So if a molecule is being oxidized by an enzyme, NADH will be being reduced, and vice versa. FAD, flavin adenine dinucleotide, is another example of a common coenzyme of oxidoreductases that functions similarly to NADH. These molecules, both coenzymes and cofactors, are often found at the active site. And that helps in the study of enzymes tremendously, because if someone does a structural study of an enzyme and they find where the cofactor or coenzyme bind, then they can oftentimes quickly find the active site as well. So how does the topic of cofactors and coenzymes relate to vitamins and minerals? Well, in the case of minerals, such as iron, zinc, cobalt, and others that can be taken as supplements, we recognize that those are used as cofactors for enzymes. Hence, it is necessary to obtain a certain level of those via the diet or via supplements. In the case of vitamins, such as the ones listed here and some of their sources, vitamins we know as organic molecules that are required for normal health and normal growth. The reason why they're required for normal health and normal growth is because vitamins are either directly used as coenzymes, organic molecules that enable the function of enzymes, or these vitamins are modified by chemical reactions in the body to ultimately become coenzymes. So it's that role of vitamins in enabling the function of enzymes that makes vitamins essential for good health. There are many, many examples that we could talk about here. One of those is that the B vitamins are known for their role in energy generation and metabolism. Vitamin B2 is a precursor of FAD. Remember from our earlier discussion just a moment ago that FAD is required for oxidation and reduction reactions, and hence vitamin B2 as an FAD precursor ultimately enables molecules within the body to be oxidized and reduced, which is a key component of a variety of metabolic processes. Vitamin B3, another one of the B vitamins, also known as niacin, vitamin B3 or niacin is a precursor to NAD. And as a precursor to NAD and related molecule NADH, it is also ultimately involved in oxidation and reduction reactions that are prevalent in a variety of metabolic processes. Vitamins are classified into two groups, water-soluble and fat-soluble vitamins. To understand which type of solvent, fat or water, a vitamin is soluble in, we think back to our understanding of intermolecular interactions and like dissolves like, keeping in mind that if a molecule has a variety of polar hydrogen bonding groups, such as hydroxy groups or amino groups, it is likely to be water soluble. On the other hand, if it is rich with aliphatic groups, such as alkanes or alkenes, and has relatively few polar groups, then the molecule is more likely to be fat soluble. It's important to be able to distinguish between these two types of vitamins because water-soluble vitamins are not generally stored by the body. Instead, they are excreted in urine. As a consequence of that, it is hard to overdose on those vitamins. That's the pro. The con is that since those vitamins are readily excreted in urine in a period of days, it's essential to have a consistent supply of those provided to the body through our diet or through supplements. Vitamin C is an example of a vitamin that must be consumed relatively consistently. Otherwise, if it's not, and the levels of vitamin C drop off in the body, diseases such as scurvy and other conditions can result. Fat-soluble vitamins, on the other hand, are stored in the body and can be stored for relatively long periods of time. The pro of that is those vitamins don't necessarily have to be obtained every single day. The con is that there can be possibly toxic side effects if they're taken in excess because they can't simply be readily eliminated through urine. Instead, they will build up in the body because they will solubilize within the fat in the body and not be effectively transported out via water-soluble urine. Now let's take a look at some examples of common water-soluble vitamins shown here in all of these images. We will notice the common theme amongst these structures is that we see an abundance of polar groups dominating the molecules. For example, COH carboxylic acid groups are a common feature across many of these structures. I'm not highlighting all of them, just highlighting a few to give you an idea of that. We also commonly see hydroxy groups, alcohols that is, showing up throughout these molecules is a very common theme. Again, I'm not highlighting all of these, just picking a few out to highlight here to illustrate the commonness of those groups within these molecules. We also very typically see amines and amides, which are also an example of a polar functional group that we will observe in these molecules. And so with that kept in mind, these molecules have a relatively high ratio of polar functional groups to nonpolar functional groups throughout these structures. On the other hand, let's take a look at our fat-soluble vitamins instead. Our fat-soluble vitamins, shown here as a point of contrast, instead have a relatively high ratio of aliphatic groups compared to the amount of water-soluble group that is expected. There are polar groups that are there. So for example, in the case of vitamin A, also known as retinol, this entire group that we see here in green is all very, very nonpolar, very aliphatic because it's consistent of hydrocarbons, which are very nonpolar. Similarly, vitamin D also is strongly aliphatic and nonpolar because this whole region of the molecule here is all hydrocarbon. And the only polar component is just that little hydroxy group there, and that is not enough to make the molecule as a whole water-soluble. We see the same sort of trend all the way down the table with gigantic aliphatic groups and only tiny groups that we would expect to be water-soluble. As a result, these molecules ultimately are fat-soluble rather than water-soluble, making them persist longer in the body than their water-soluble counterparts that are easily passed out of the body via urine.